Mr. Blue Sky, please tell us why you had to hide away for so long.
Welcome everybody to another EMC episode. I'm Trent, this is obviously
Drew.
There you go. And we're here talking today mainly about Guardians Volume 2. We went and saw it special preview night on Thursday. Now, before we get into the review, before we start doing any of that, if you haven't seen it, well, for one, what's the matter with you? You should have gone and seen it already. But if you haven't, there's the possibility of us bringing in spoilers with this. So if you don't want the movie spoiled for you and you don't want to hear the spoilers, click away now.
Leave.
This is definitely, go check out one of our other videos.
Don't let it be spoiled. It was pretty good.
Go check out one of our other videos, then go watch Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, then come back, and we'll review it. Okay? That should give you enough time.
If they didn't, they're stupid.
Yeah. On with the review.
Okay.
All right. What did you think, man? You've seen it twice now.
I've seen it twice.
I've only had time to go see it once.
I've seen it twice.
Which, it's usually the other way around.
I know. Usually I'm the one who sees it once and then goes home.
And I've seen it like four times in a weekend, usually.
Yeah. I really liked it. For me, I thought they did a great job with characters. Every character kind of had a moment. There wasn't a character I particularly didn't like, which is rare for me. Usually I find someone I hate, you know. I always find someone I hate, and I couldn't think of anyone in that movie I hated, which is a good thing.
Yeah.
For me, the best, I really like Drax. Best.
I thought that his character was a little bit more comic relief. Like, he was comic relief in the last film too, but it was more of a straight end, where this is like just that straight style, where this one he was just funny.
He broke up all the serious moments, which is kind of one of the points of Guardians of the Galaxy, is every time something serious is happening, something funny immediately follows it.
Usually, yeah.
And to me, he killed it with that job. The only, it's not even a criticism, because it's not a criticism. When I went and saw the first Guardians of the Galaxy, I had no expectation of it being good.
Right.
And was extremely, obviously, pleasantly surprised with how great it was. With this one, I had an idea that it was going to be a really good movie, and it was, but it was missing some of that specialness, because there was no pleasant surprise. It just kind of met expectation.
Right.
And I think my only other thing is it was, I don't want to say it was slow, because it certainly wasn't slow for me, but it a little bit in the middle of the movie, little bit more action here and there would have been kind of nice for me. But that being said, that's a very minor thing. It's not like it was a blatant lack of
like
action.
It just seemed to drag for you in the middle.
Oh, a smidge.
A smidge, yeah. Like
Yondu when he's on that ship escaping.
Yeah.
And he's just kind of powering through and killing everyone. Wicked.
Yeah.
Awesome. But.
That, yeah. Groot, obviously adorable and hilarious at the same time. But yeah, Yondu. That was my character in this one.
Yondu was great. It was great.
I'm Mary Poppins, y'all. Like that was
a great
favorite.
Is he cool? Yeah, he's cool. I'm Mary Poppins.
I love that. I thought that was great. Kurt Russell being Ego is just, it makes sense. And Stallone. I am a Stallone fan, right?
You
and
are.
There's so many people that like just shit talk Rambo and Rocky and
the
Expendables
shit,
and everything,
right.
But he's the only person alive to have a number one blockbuster hit in 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, and 2010s. Like, Who else has done that?
Yeah. I'm not saying he's good.
I dare you to find someone else that was a main character, main star like Sylvester Stallone to do that.
I'm not going
to
give
him
an Oscar, but
he's
good. I do
actually
have
one. He already has an Oscar for Rocky, for best screenplay.
Yeah, but...
So I'm really glad that he's still around and kicking. I'm happy about that. But Yondu, his character, I really loved the redemption and all that they gave him. And just the backstories for everybody, like, which they kind of did in the middle, so it's kind of where it did drag, because they were just talking about like how they are, the way, like why they became this way, right? So I can understand why it dragged, and yeah, it's not original anymore because it's a sequel, right? It's kind of like Terminator 2 or Empire Strikes Back, both awesome kind of action flicks.
Shut the first.
But they're kind of their own movie in their own right.
If you had to pick a least favorite character, which is hard, because once again, there was no character. I would go.
It's not that hard for me because I just.
I agree though.
I don't know. That character really wasn't fully invested in. I understand the growing up with Mad, like Thanos as your dad and ripping you apart and
for me,
putting metal in you doesn't. That's not the best childhood, but
for me, I didn't like the switch to good. Like I actually liked her in the first movie better because she was just evil.
I think the switch to good was just too quick.
Yeah, okay, maybe that was it, because it was like 1 minute she's like, you can't trust her, she's pure evil, blah blah blah.
Yeah.
And then she's like, hug me, sister, and I'm like, come on.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the only part that, that I didn't really care for. But can we just take a moment to just appreciate? We all need to just take a moment to appreciate. And once you've seen it, you know what I'm talking about.
Okay.
The title sequence of Groot. Just that opening title sequence, I think, was just
classic.
I've never seen anything like it. And I thought it was great. I can't think of another movie that's done something like that. Like, there's been, like, elaborate openings, like Austin Powers, when he did that whole, like, extravagant opening for the beginning of the title sequence, man. Like, James Bond's, they all have, like, their theme song going.
Yep.
Which, this had, like a opening song, pretty much, which was ELL and Mr. Blue Sky. Great tune. And since this movie's come out, I've been hearing that song all over the place.
Okay.
Like in other TV shows, other stuff, just, it's like when you buy a certain car and then you start driving it and the next like week or so you see that same car.
Because you're
same thing.
For it. One of the things that always people always talk about Guardians of the Galaxy, the soundtracks. Second movie, killer soundtrack. First movie, had a killer soundtrack. Worked great with both films. Which one had the better soundtrack, Trent? Trent's a huge music guy, so I strongly always go with his opinion on music.
That is
a professional.
That's an incredible question, because they both have.
It's different.
It's different, yet they did almost keep it the same, with pacing, with the music.
Mm-hmm.
If you go back and watch Guardians 1, where there's that slow part with Star-Lord and Gamora dancing. Right? Nice and fool around, fell in love, Elvin Bishop, incredible tune. Right? I love that song. And then you look at this one, same thing, they're having their moment.
Yep.
And it's another style of song, right? There's a lot of similarities with what songs they've chosen for this movie from the first movie. Now, I don't know, because I really love the first soundtrack. There's some incredible tunes on it, like Red Bone, Come Get Your Love, and like I said, Elvin Bishop and Marvin Gaye for Eatin' Alone High, Two Pina Coladas, and same with Hooked on a Feeling. Like, yeah, they're catchy songs, but they're corny songs. Like, let's not beat around the bush here. They are corny songs, where they were kind of going with that same element this time around, but I think they were able to get better rights to better songs.
Yeah, I was actually just going to say that.
And because they got Cheap Trick Surrendered. You can never go wrong with any Cheap Trick song. You can never go wrong with any ELO song. You can never go wrong with Cat Stevens or Sam Cooke. All those guys are great. George Harrison, My Sweet Lord, even though that was a complete ripoff of another song. But,
okay,
court settled that. But,
that's not my phone ringing.
It isn't.
Nope.
Nope, not at all.
So,
you know, it's funny because my phone just went off in my pocket. And I was thinking, okay, who's that, but unimportant.
Forget that. Okay, I was going to say my comment on the music, which I'm going to contradict myself here, okay? I thought the second movie had better music, but I liked the first soundtrack better. Because what I thought was great about the first movie, the first soundtrack, is it had a bunch of these songs, which everyone knows, but most people don't think, you know, Blue Suede, yes,
yeah.
Right? But it worked for that movie because it's funny,
yeah,
and it really, really worked.
Well, you can,
where with this movie, they had a better quality of music, yet, not to say they didn't work, I just thought that the first movie, the song choices
worked better for me.
They
still did that direction a bit because, like, they picked a Glenn Campbell song, which, Southern Nights, that's, like, every now and then I keep forgetting about Southern Nights. Same with Lakeshore Drive. No one, like, it's one of those songs that you forget about. So they did keep that element in there, where there is certain songs where it's like, oh yeah, that one, right? Like, same with, like, unless you're an ELO fan and you know Mr. Blue Sky, like, the only one that I could usually, there's only two songs from ELO that I could name right off the top of my head, Evil Woman. And, see, I can't even name two, that Don't Bring Me Down song. Don't bring me down. That one? Those are the only two. Cheap Trick, I could name you a ton. But there are, like, I could name you four different Glenn Campbell songs and not even get to Southern Nights. So they kind of, like, they kind of stuck with that, just with bigger artists, I feel. I think that's what they did.
Although when they played Fleetwood Mac, you killed it for me.
Fleetwood Mac, yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, there's another, I think this is probably the better soundtrack. Best soundtrack, I said, was Iron Man 2, because it was just AC/DC greatest hits. That's all it was. AC/DC fan, obviously, I'm going to love it. So rating time, how do you want to rate this? Do you want to rate it from like a letter grade, or do you want to rate it from like best out of 10?
Let's do it out of 10. Let's go out of 10.
Okay. Well, and you can do like 7 point, like you can do like points, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think?
9 out of 10.
9 out of 10?
Almost impossible for a movie to be perfect for me. And this movie wasn't perfect for me. It was great.
Yeah.
With very little complaints, so I give it 9 out of 10.
I'm going to have to go like 8.8.
Oh, you're more critical than me.
I know. Because of the Nebula Gamora thing. Like, it just... It dragged a bit for me. And like you said, yeah, the middle did drag a bit, but still thought it was amazing. Don't get me wrong. But yeah, I feel like it's 0.2 difference from what you're saying, but it's not 9 to me.
Okay.
Like,
no, fair enough then.
I feel Guardians is 9, the first one, and this is like 8.8, which it's still right up there. But that original quality of it, I don't know.
I don't even know if I would give it. I don't think I've seen a Marvel movie yet. 10 out of 10. There's always something.
The first Avengers, like 9.9, I would give.
I'd give it a 9.5.
Yeah.
I wouldn't give it the 10.
Yeah, that one is tough. Let us know what you think. What do you rate it? For everybody who's seen the movie and the people who haven't, go see it.
So,
and if you've watched this movie, and if you watch this review without watching the movie, here on out, I hope I didn't spoil it for you. But if I did, well, shame on you. You shouldn't have watched this movie. You shouldn't have watched this first. You should have gone to see the movie.
And just so we can quantify the scale here, 1 is like X-Men Last Stand.
Or The Room with Tommy Wiseau.
I did not hit her.
Oh, hi, Mark.
I'm going to go X-Men Last Stand is the worst movie I've ever seen, by the way.
Watch The Room, and then you'll...
So that's that.
Yeah.
And then 10, what's a movie that would get a 10?
A movie that would get a 10?
We need to set precedence.
Like superhero movies?
Doesn't have to be superhero movie.
Well, what? Well, 10.
I guess, okay, we should make it a superhero.
If we stick with superhero, then like The Dark Knight and The Avengers, it would be close to 10s. Those are like
really,
the closest,
really close.
They're the closest to 10s that you...
All right, we'll go with that.
And Logan. Logan, too.
Haven't seen it yet.
I know
you're failing everyone.
That and Deadpool. Like, those four.
Okay, Deadpool was a 10 out of 10 for me. Yeah. It had everything I wanted out of it.
Yeah.
Because it didn't...
There we go, we found it, Deadpool.
Deadpool's the best Marvel movie ever.
Best superhero movie, because it's Fox, technically. It's Marvel,
stop
but
reading
it's Fox,
stop
and
reading
it's just annoying.
Shh, stop reading it. All right, guys.
Give it back.
Give it back. All right, guys, thank you very much. And,
yes.
Make sure you tune in for our next video. We're going to be talking about the Defenders trailer.
Yes, and make sure you like, subscribe, comment, do whatever you want, all right? See you in the next video.
Out. Oh.